Well, here we are, part three of chapter three, Measurable Organizational Value, MOV, and the business case. Let me go ahead and jump to the slide that we left off with. And on this slide, we were talking about step three of this one methodology for developing a business case, and that's identifying alternatives. Now, here are some examples, by the way, of some possible options. Now, keep in mind that especially as IT professionals, we're constantly looking at putting that square business process into an IT solution. And sometimes, and maybe even a lot of times, the best solution is not a technology solution. It's simply changing the process. Now, I think I mentioned in a previous video that I was involved in a project where we were implementing a document management system, and the fact became very clear very quickly that we were trying to take a very poor, non-technical business process. Granted, there were forms in there, but the business process itself needed improvement. And in this case, what happened was management was so pushing because the cost of these document management forms was so tremendous that we just wanted to shove this into a technology solution. And what we ended up with was a more complex, more troublesome, and more challenging technology solution than the challenge we were trying to solve. Okay, so what we ended up doing is going back to the table, starting again, which means the investment we had made, a lot of that investment provided no value to the company, okay? So when we started the process again, we were spending money that we already spent. We were spending it twice. And that, of course, increased our return on investment timeframe, okay, which we'll talk about. But my point is, in that case, we had to go back and lean out the business process, make a better business process, so that we could take a great business process and implement an IT solution for it. So sometimes process without investing in IT is perfectly fine. Okay, we can spend more money in technology, in servers, in people to maintain it, and programmers to build it, than the challenge is for the company. Okay, you know, meaning whatever is being lost, whatever we're trying to solve, the problem or challenge, as I like to call it. So adopting or adapting an application, you know, developed by a different area or department within the organization. So again, we need to look what's out there. If we already have a database in one department and another department is looking, you know, to do more, implementing what they need into an existing database than having a database that does what they need and a database for another company, always a great idea. That's why we see systems like enterprise resource planning that literally have components or modules to manage and maintain the front end of the business, i.e. marketing and sales, all the way to the end of customer support. Okay, so, you know, whatever product or service we manufacture and the support. Re-engineering the existing system if we're replacing a current system. You know, purchasing an off-the-shelf application package from a vendor. There's also the idea custom building a new application using internal resources, outsourcing the development to another company. Those are options. Also, we may be able to deal with a software vendor who is willing to customize or give us custom programming to make that unique. Now, keep in mind that one of the questions I always like to ask companies is simply this. What is the value of the process? Meaning, if there's a system we can purchase off the shelf that does a different process, is that business process a competitive advantage to the company? Or do we in fact need to change the business process so that it's implemented in the software so that we can use the software without customization? So those are the kind of questions that we really need to be asking as we look at identifying alternatives. And remember, one of the alternatives not listed there is to do nothing about the challenge that we have. Okay, maybe there's bigger challenges for us to conquer, if you will. So define feasibility and assess risk. So, you know, notice here feasibility, going back to the Steve Jobs idea of an iPod, it wasn't technically feasible because the technology didn't exist to make a small enough device that would fit in your pocket. So consequently, part of that project became building and implementing technology so that they could meet the ultimate goal of a music player that would fit in your pocket, okay? And look how quickly they went from that huge player to that little 1x1 inch player that, you know, had a clip that could clip to, you know, your hat band and off you went on a run or working out. Just absolutely amazing. So feasibility, is it economically feasible? Thus, can we afford it? You know, is it doable? That should be doable or worth doing. Is it feasible within the organization? Meaning, do we have the human resources? Do we have the talent? Do we have the time to do it within our organization? And then, of course, other feasibilities. You know, for example, what's the feasibility of us not doing a project? Okay. Meaning, sometimes we get stuck doing projects that we don't necessarily as an organization want to do, but it's something that we have to do, maybe to remain competitive within our industry. We need to look at risks. So, you know, identifying the risks, what can go wrong, what must go right. So not just what can go wrong, but what must go right. So if we have a key player in this, an expert, say, in our organization, what must go right is that we keep that person to keep this project on track, because maybe it's such a unique person within our organization that there's not very many people filling that job role. And we know that if we lose that person, we're looking at a 6-month delay in getting someone else in. Not to mention, if that person's been with the organization for a while, they have knowledge that we may not be able to retain if they leave the organization. So, you know, assess the impact. So again, what's the impact on the project? In my example, it may be that the project has to stop till we get a content expert in to get the project up and rolling again. You know, how can the organization avoid or minimize the risk? So what is it we can do to avoid that? You know, a great example here that a lot of people don't think about is, what happens if somebody on the project team gets sick and they're out for 2 weeks or they're out for a week? You know, what's the impact on the project and how are we going to work that? So consequently, what this means is go do studies. Maybe go to human resources and find out how often someone within the project team calls in sick. You know, if this is someone who has a child that needs more care, so this person calls in sick on a regular basis, how might we be able to give them the resources to work remotely so that they can both take care of the sick child as well as work? Or is it that in our timeline, we need to build in those sick days? Okay, so keep in mind, something as simple as, oh gee, this person works 40 hours a week. Maybe over the month, they don't work 173.33 hours. They only average 165 hours. So build that into your project. Step 5 in developing the business case, defining the total cost of ownership. So notice direct or upfront costs, ongoing costs, indirect costs. So I give you an example here of total cost of ownership. You can pause and read that. Let me give you an example here. Best example I have is buying a car. When we talk about total cost of ownership of a car, we need to look at a lot of things. Number one, if we're going to finance the car, how does our credit affect the interest rate we get? How much interest are we going to pay? What's the price of the car? Have we done research to find out what the annual maintenance fees are said to be? Have we gone out to consumer reports to find out, well, you know, Toyota says their maintenance fees, you know, every year are $500, but in this model I'm buying, the last 5 model years has resulted in $1,100 of maintenance fees. Okay, things seem to be going wrong on the model. Do I still want to buy the model? That's not the point here. The point is total cost of ownership. You know, if it's a red car, is my insurance going to be more? Are the kids going to drive it? Do I have to insure them on it? you know, am I going to do any customization to the car? You know, my annual gas bill for the car? Am I planning on keeping the car for 5 years? Then I look at all my expenses, realizing that maintenance is probably going to increase towards the end. Have I built that in? To look at what the real cost of buying the car is. So it's not just a fact of buying the car, it's knowing and understanding to the best of our ability the total cost of ownership. So when we talk about an IT project, bringing this back in, gee, cloud sounds like a great option, but maybe, in fact, it's not a great option at all. When we start looking at the monthly fees for cloud and needing to hire a cloud engineer who specializes in managing cloud versus someone who can manage it locally. Maybe we already have talent that can manage it locally. We could retrain that person. You get the idea. Define total benefits of ownership. So increased, you know, high value of work, improved accuracy or efficiency, improved decision making. So, you know, are we retaining more knowledge that we can go back? Are we combining data? Are we going back into a data warehouse and pulling data we already have to find better information? You know, what are the benefits to ownership? What are the benefits to the business, if you will? Improving customer service, always a good one. Analyze the alternatives. So, you know, one of the ways as we analyze alternatives, we can look at the time to payback, you know, initial or total cost of ownership. So what I mean by that is we can just look at initial costs. We also need to look at total cost of ownership. A great example of this is when I worked for an insurance company, the current vendor they had, this was back before Windows, by the way, had developed a Windows Server version of their software. They made it very enticing to get on that version because they wanted to sunset the old version. However, what we ended up doing is become a beta testing organization for them. We didn't realize this in the process. Frankly, the general manager made the decision with the executive board to buy the software, and people like me who had some experience at the time in project management weren't involved. The result was this, by the way. They had an alternative to the current DOS-based system. They had built a Linux solution first before they built a Windows solution. The Windows solution was coming. I got a disk. We were on a NetWare system. We were leveraging Windows. They did not have a GUI-based system. We had to wait 6 months to get a Windows system. And then again, it was beta. It was going down all the time. The total cost of ownership far, far exceeded the cost of the old system in the aspect of benefits we didn't have and functionality we didn't have in the old system. So you really got to be careful, and hopefully that's a nice example of making sure the right people are involved in a project. So as we look at payback periods, though, the initial investment, you know, divided by the cash flow. So in this case, if we invest $100,000 and it creates $20,000 in revenue annually, we're looking at 5 years as our payback period. Okay, so break even, here's an example that I have for you. And that is an idea that I actually had to consider, which is an additional IT worker. So for a consulting company, as we look at wages, I was gonna pay this person $25 an hour. I've come up with these are not exact numbers. So just, you know, just play along and use your imagination. Other personal expenses per hour. So those could be, you know, what it costs me, personnel expenses, what it costs me in the way of insurance and the taxes I pay for the employee, et cetera. Overhead for additional employee, meaning, you know, I've got to have a desk for them. I may, you know, need to move and have an office. I'm paying for reimbursement on their mileage as they go out to customers, et cetera. Anyway, you get the idea of those, what those things could be. Okay, and in that, it's $47.75. So if I hired this additional IT worker full time, it would cost me $47.75 per hour, or $8,276 a month. That's 170 based on 173.33 hours. Okay. So if I'm charging my clients $75 an hour for technical support, then in order to just break even on this employee, I have to bill 110.35 hours in a month just to break even on the employee. Okay. So I really got to look at, do I have enough work to employ another employee? Because remember, we talked about alternatives. Maybe alternatives, if I don't have that work, is to look at the overtime cost of an existing employee I have, going to them and say, hey, are you willing to put in overtime? Or is there a means for me to hire a part-time person? And what are the benefits there? So there's two examples of alternatives to this business case, if you will. But notice in the business case, I've got my MOV here and I'm working with it to decide if it's worth taking on the business case. All right, that's it for this part. I will see you in part 4. Take care.